I've been redeemed.
I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
Say it again, say his blood.
His blood still works, and I'm to
redeemed. Yes, I am. Testify, God is not dead, he's still alive. The same blood that was shed way back at Calvary is the same blood that's working now for me. Oh, his blood redeems me from the stain of sin. His blood cleanses me deep down within. So if you ask me how I made it and how I've overcome, I can tell you it's because of the blood.
His blood still works, and I'm glad to report that.
Morning, church. Good morning. Good morning. It's a privilege to be in the house of God this morning. I just want to, first of all, acknowledge God's presence, allowing God for, first of all, bringing us throughout another week and allow us to be in the house today. No better place to be than the house of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So just give thanks, and I want to appreciate and acknowledge Bishop and Sister D, who's not with us today, but we give thanks for them both, for their love, their kindness towards us. And I'll just pray for you all, and thank you all for the brethren to be here today and those who are watching online as well. And we just would like to start with an opening prayer, if we could settle down. And let's just, if you can stand, please stand. And let's just pray and give God thanks this morning. Lord God, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for Father God this day. We thank you for keeping us, Lord, first of all, giving us life another day. Lord God, you are awesome. You are mighty God. You are Father God, a precious God, a gracious God that keeps us, gives us the strength. Lord God, I thank you for, Father God, the opportunity, Lord, which you have given us to, Father God, worship you, Lord, each day where that we have breath. Lord, we must give you praise and acknowledge that you are holy, that you are Father God, a God of power, a God of love, and a God of wrath at the same time, but a God of, Father God, meekness, Lord God, because you are awesome, Lord. You are worthy, Lord God. And right now I pray that you would just allow this service to be, Lord Father God, a blessing to us all, that, Father God, we will be able to, Father God, seek your presence, seek your, Father God, your presence, Lord, and understand, Lord God, that we must, Father God, hear your voice and worship you, Lord, in spirit and in truth, Lord God. I pray, Lord, that the love, Lord God, that you showed on us will also be reciprocated in our lives, Lord, that we show to others, Lord God. I pray that you will, Let your will be done, Lord, and have your way in this, in our lives, in this service, Lord. And as we leave this place today, that we'll be able to, Father God, receive something from your word and from your presence, Lord. I pray that you have your way right now. As we thank you, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. We're going to start by singing Praise Him. Praise Him. That's what the angels do in heaven. All day long, just praising God and in his presence. So let us just sing and worship God together. Hallelujah.
Look.
Hallelujah. Is there anyone that loves Jesus? Is there anyone that loves God this morning? Hallelujah. We're coming to his house with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord. We give you glory. We honor you because you are majestic. You are mighty. You are holy. You are... Hallelujah. I love him because he first loved me. He first loved you. He loved all of us. He loved the church. We fail him, but God never fails us. Hallelujah. You're worthy, God. I love him. Hallelujah. Even when I don't deserve it, I still love him. Blessed Savior. Hallelujah. Sing, I love him. My salvation. See you.
praise him this morning. Let's give him glory. Hallelujah. We can't stop praising him. Hallelujah. You're worthy, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let the church say amen this morning. Let the church say amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let the church say amen. We're going to sing that song. If you know that song, let's sing it together. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I feel like worshiping this morning. I feel like giving him praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. God has spoken.
God has spoken.
So let the church.
Let the church say amen.
Sing, let the church say amen.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen.
Sing, God has spoken. Let the church,
say amen.
Sing, let the church say amen.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen.
Sing, God has spoken.
God has spoken.
So let the church say. Let the church,
let the church
say amen.
Amen.
Sing, let the church say amen. Sing, let the church say amen.
Let the church say amen.
God has spoken.
Let the church.
The voices I want to hear sing. Sing, let the church. Sing, let the church say. Sing,
God has spoken.
Sing, let the church.
Let the church
say amen. One more time without the music. Let the church say.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken.
So let the church.
Let the church say amen.
Hallelujah.
Let the church say.
give him praise. Hallelujah. You're worthy, God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Jesus, we thank you. Hallelujah. It's good to praise God this morning. After the evangelism service that we had yesterday, which was powerful service, which I watched online because I was unable to make it, but it was such a privilege to be in the presence of God, just to worship, and the unbelievers that came to get to know Christ there's no better feeling of bringing new unsaved people to the altar to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's a blessing. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We're just going to ask our sister Navona or sister Margaret to come and give the notices, and then after that we're going to be giving our tithes and offering and giving God's glory to God.
On the behalf of our Minister Bishop Winston Taylor, 50D, and the leadership team, we'd just like to welcome each and everyone this morning to our worship service. We also want to welcome all those who are worshiping with us online. This morning on our prayer list, we have our Sister Bent, who is asking for special prayers, and all those who are sick, our elderly and shut-ins, and all our families who are bereaved, just be reminded to keep them in your prayers. Please join us every Sunday morning at 7 a.m. and Mondays at 7:30 p.m. via Zoom for prayer. And if you need the information for the Zoom link, please see myself after service. Bible studies are held weekly on Tuesdays. We have the Kingdom Living class, and on Wednesdays we have the Spotlight class. Both classes are held at 7:30 p.m. via Zoom. Please note that there will be no new converts group this Friday. However, classes will resume on Friday, the 24th of May at 6 p.m. at our Family Life Center. And this is because our convention starts this Friday. Our Sheffield District Convention starts Friday the 17th to Sunday the 19th of May. Please note that the session on Friday starts at 7 p.m. And we're asking you to please attend and support this convention throughout the weekend. Invite a friend, invite your families. Convention fee is £10. Please see our Sister Margaret or myself as soon as possible with your convention fee. Our National United Convention will be held at the ICC Newport, Wales, from Friday the 23rd to Sunday the 25th of August. Please note that the early bird rate is still ongoing, so please make the most of that. Our next Women Discipleship Ministry meeting will be held at our Family Life Center on Friday, the 24th of May at 7:30 p.m. And all ladies, you're asking to please make an extra effort to attend this meeting. Choir practice will be held on Thursday, which is this Thursday coming, at 7:30 p.m. And our Elder MacPherson is asking all senior members to please make the extra effort to attend this practice. For all those wanting to go to Isle of Wight in October, please note that next week is the deadline for your deposits to be paid. Ahead of our June Windrush celebration service, please join us for our Windrush event day on Saturday, May 25th at our Family Life Center, and this will start at 11 a.m. Please invite your families and friends to share stories and photos of the Windrush generation. And for more information, please see our Sister Patricia Dixon or our brother Delroy Robinson. The media team will now be playing a video which will give you more information about the Windrush celebration. God bless you all.
We are inviting you to join us for a Windrush celebration service, the Caribbean nation answer Britain's call from our warm island to the cool steel city of Sheffield, where we forge together in the struggle It's a celebration service like no other.
For
every generation. Welcoming all to the community. Theme is Sanctuary of Belonging. Church's contribution in the Windrush story. Make it a date, Sunday the 23rd of June. All NTCG churches in the UK are celebrating Windrush. So the place to be at is 1 Johnson Street, Sheffield. Starting from 11 a.m. to 1:30 p.m. Honoring the past, celebrating the present, and embracing the future. See.
Video got cut short a bit there, but we still praise him. But yeah, so hope you got your notepad and your pen out and took a few notes there. It's a lot of things to remember. So yeah, thank you for that, Sister Navarre and the media team. So we're going to have our offering now. If the ushers could please take their places, and if you could please stand, and let's worship together. We're going to sing if you want to see the glory of the Lord. Why don't we praise him?
Your hands and
thank you for, Lord, the gifts, Lord, which you've allowed your children and to give to you, to your glory, Lord, this morning. We just thank you for each, Lord, Father God, individual that is able to give, and even those who are unable to give. We just thank you, Lord, Father God, for them. We just pray right now that it would be to your goodness and to your glory. In the name of Jesus, we thank you. Amen. Hallelujah. We're going to sing one more song before I'm going to hand over to Bishop. And the song is, Blessed Be Your Name in a Land That Is Plentiful. So let's bless the name of the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. If you know the song, the words will be on the screen. Amen. Sister Mavita, if you could just say a quick word of prayer for as Bishop Taylor comes to deliver his word this morning. Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we give you thanks, Lord God. We thank you for being here with us, Lord God. We pray, Heavenly Father, for Bishop as he comes, Lord God, to deliver the word. Heavenly Father, I pray that you will continue to use him, Lord God, that every word that you've given him, Lord God, will be receptive, Lord God, to us, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, that we'll open up our eyes, open up our ears, open up our heart, Lord God, to receive what you have in store for us. Heavenly Father, continue to use him, Lord God. Be with him, Lord God. Heavenly Father, as we, Lord God, hear what he has to say, Lord Jesus. Hear what you have to say, Heavenly Father. Lord God, continue to use him. Bless him, Lord Jesus, as he comes in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. If you could please remain standing as Bishop Taylor comes to deliver his word. Amen.
Thank you, saints. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. God is good, and all the time. Amen. He really is a good God. Amen. It's so good to be in the house of God again and to see you all. Some of you I haven't seen for a while, but you're back in the house of the Lord today. We give God thanks for you. The Lord has been with us, certainly been with us over this weekend. I really wish that you could have been there. Those of you who chose not to come, you should have been there at the street ministry. You should have been there. All I would say is that God does some wonderful things. He's past finding out, he's past understanding. And I would really wish that one of the things that we could do as a church is just step up our level of engagement with evangelism. Just step up. If it was even for some of you just to have been there, just to support as we do what we do. I think that's something that we need to fix, something that we need to adjust. But to God be the glory. Even though some of us weren't there, God still did his thing. But I want you to remember, saints of God, please, you got to get this. The last thing Jesus said before he left the world, go into all the world. It was on his heart. It was on his heart. And I want it to encourage us. Whenever we go out into the street, even if you're not one of these people that's going to, you're not gregarious, you're not going to run around and shake people's hand. Maybe you don't have that ability yet, but certainly supporting the cause is something really worth doing, because your eyes will be open and your heart will be enlightened. So God bless you. And then the evening service, Leeds have the pleasure of the man of God this morning. I almost wish I could just fly over there, split myself in two, and fly over to Leeds, but it can't be that way. But we pray for him as we pray for one another. Is that all right? Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. So whatever we're doing this week, please be in prayer for the convention, which starts on Friday. We seek to do everything that we can on time. So let's start with a bang on Friday at 7 o'clock. And I believe that the convention weekend will hold riches for us. And I really believe that we'll be blessed. We have two young men coming to speak to us who I believe will challenge us, as well as we can call her youngish lady, who will be speaking in the women's ministry. So we're looking forward to all that God will do. And once again, we just crave your support. If by the way, can I just say this, just for the avoidance of any doubt, there are no more places for meals. So if you didn't book a ticket, you'll either have to go home and cook, or go to McDonald's, or go to KFC, or whatever. But there are no more tickets. That's done now. Okay. The deadline is gone, and the tickets have been printed. It's done now. Okay. So we'll deal with the aftermath after convention. And if you want to take a swipe at me, you can. I got big, broad shoulders. I can take it. But it is what it is. We have been asking you for weeks now, so please, I'm going to ask you that if you do, after Sunday session at convention, if you feel a little bit hungry and think that you might get a dinner at the Life Center, you won't get one without a ticket. Is that clear? So as not to cause any embarrassment, please. and Sister Navone will be there to police the situation. So she can take all the stones. I certainly won't be. Amen. We'll try and do something else for next year, if the situation allows. All right. Enough of that. Let's go to the Word. Let's go to the Word. We're going to be looking at Hebrews chapter 13 this morning. Not quite afternoon yet. This morning. So would you stand for the reading of the Word, please? Hebrews chapter 13. We're going to be reading from verses 1 to 8. Hebrews chapter 13, 1 to 8. 1, 2, 3, let's read. Let brotherly love continue. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Remember them that are in bonds as bound with them, and them which suffer adversity as being yourselves also in the body. So that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. Remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. I wonder if you could read that one more time, that verse 7, please. Go back to verse 7. Let's read that verse 7, and we'll close on verse 8. Remember them which have the rule over you, which have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. Let us say amen to the reading of the word of God. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Amen. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. It's worth saying again. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. Amen. I believe that I can say without any doubt that there is a lot of change taking place in our world today. Would you agree? A lot of change? Why don't you turn to your neighbor for 15 seconds and tell them something that is changing? Worth a discussion, huh? Amen. But it's not so much the fact that the world is changing, but it's the pace at which the world is changing. The world has always changed. Things have always altered. Things never remain the same for too long. Things change. Some change are good changes, some change are not so good. The world that we live in, that we share, is changing in many different levels, all of which at some point, sooner or later, will affect the way that we're living. We are seeing changes in the weather pattern. Climate change is reshaping our world and leaving an indelible impression or a mark on our ecosystems, the systems that we need for our survival. The rise in temperature, amen, is speeding up the melting of the ice. Who would have believed it, huh? In our coldest regions, endangering polar habitats and contributed to sea level rise, thereby threatening even some of our coastal cities. Hurricanes, brothers and sisters, wildfires, and other extreme events are disrupting lives and economies. agriculture faces challenges with shifting growing seasons and unpredictable weather patterns, jeopardizing the food that we have been taking so much for granted over the years. Human health is at risk as disease spreads in our warmer climates. It can truly be said that all around us, there is change. There are changes in our society and in the way that we view traditional and God-ordained truth about our very basic humanity. In much of today's society, even the very line that distinguishes manhood from womanhood has blurred. Oh yes, many of our leading politicians, and you will be voting for some of them real soon, our community leaders, and sad though it is, the very teachers that we entrust our children with are afraid to lose their jobs if they stand up and say that a man just cannot become a woman just because they say so. To stand up publicly for what is obvious and true is to risk losing their livelihoods. And many have been silenced through fear. It is true, all around us there is change. On our TV screens, radio and social media, there is what we call disinformation and misinformation, to the point where if you're not careful, we hardly know what is true any longer. Disinformation, that intentional, false, misleading, spreading things that are not true in order to deceive and to manipulate the people. This disinformation is always propagated by individuals and groups and organizations for various reasons, such as political gain, economic profit, or even ideological motives. Disinformation comes in the form of what we call fake news, propaganda, manipulation of the social media. That's why you have to be careful that you don't just believe everything that you see. You have to check and double check and triple check, because there is so much false narrative out there. It is done to influence us and to undermine trust in the things that we hold dear. It is deliberate. It is rife. And all around us there is change. In God's church and among God's people there is change. The change we are seeing seems to be revolving around a lack of holiness and holy living amongst the people of God. Holiness for the believer, as we know it, is living a pure life. Holiness is being set apart for service unto God. Holiness involves many aspects, but essentially it is living in right standing before God. And 1 Peter 2:9 speaks of this holiness status, as he said that you are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation, a people for his own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Amen. In addition to being made holy, we are called to live holy. 1 Peter 1:15 says, as he who has called you is holy, you also should be holy in all your conduct. Amen. The previous verse adds, as obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance. We are commanded to avoid the ways that we used to live, the practices that we used to have before becoming a Christian. And God is asking us in holiness to live lives worthy of him. And there's only one way that we can do this, saints, is by living in the power of the Holy Spirit and following God's foundational word. The changes we see about us are taking place in the church because God's people have adopted a different standard of living for their lives than the holiness of God. It is therefore a natural outcome of our living that sin is ignored. Disobedience is rank among us. Amen. And righteousness and godly living is sacrificed on the altar of personal convenience. And God, one of these days, God is going to find us out. You can only get away with it for so long. You can trump as much as you want, talk as much as you want, but God knows who are His. One of these days will be found out. The day shall declare it, surely. The day shall declare it. All around us there is a change. But I want to let you know today that the holiness of God is the foundation for our living and the foundation for all our moral values. It is the holiness of God alone that will give stability and meaning to the moral standards that we have. And I will say this categorically. What is right in God's sight today will be right forever. Let me say that again. What is right in God's sight today will be right forever. And what is wrong in God's sight today will be wrong forever. Amen. We cannot manipulate the Bible to say what we want it to say to suit our own circumstances. What God says is wrong will be eternally wrong. What God says is right will be eternally right. You know why? Because He's the same yesterday and today and forevermore. Oh, glory be to God. In the midst of these changes, in a day when what is wrong is called right and what is right is called wrong, there remains just one truth, that our Jesus, our God, is the same yesterday, the same today, and He will be the same tomorrow. When writing the book of Hebrews, the writer seems to have chosen as his theme the superiority of Jesus Christ. He talks much about Jesus being the supreme mediator of God's grace, and there's no one like Him. And when the writer mentions Jesus as being the same yesterday, today, and forever, it's really following on from some other things that he said in Hebrews chapter 12. When he wrote this, he said, "Wherefore, seeing that we are all compassed with so great a cloud of witnesses, come on, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which do easily beset us. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him," amen, "endured the cross, despised the shame, and is today set down at the right hand of the throne of God." Here, brothers and sisters, we are being encouraged by the writer, and there's debate about who wrote it, but we are being encouraged by the writer to keep our eyes firmly on Jesus and to persevere in our journey of faith. God have mercy. Keep your eyes on Jesus. I said, keep your eyes on Jesus. If your daddy tells you something that is not in the Bible, it is wrong. If your mommy tells you something not in the Bible, it's wrong. If your cousins, your aunties, your uncles do it, if it's not in the Word of God and cannot be supported by the Word of God, you have a right to reject it. This Word will set family against family. This Word will set husband against wife. This Word will set member against member. But the Word of God is true, and He will never change. because he is who he is. The same yesterday and today and forever. So we are being encouraged, you see, to keep our eyes firmly on Jesus and to persevere without faltering. And when we go back into Hebrews chapter 13 and at verse 6, we are also told to remember or to take heed to those who have the rule over us. Those people who have spoken the word of God into our lives. And I wanted to think about some of those people. For those of you who have been in the house of God for any length of time, you will know. Consider these people. Consider that they have the rule over you. Consider the things that they said to you. Consider the things that they spoke into your lives, so that we should follow the lives and the faith of those who have trusted in God and have gone on before us. However, saints of God, the guidance of these wonderful men and women only has true value if what they said is true and is in line with the immutable truth of God. That God remains constant across time. Brothers and sisters, I put it to you. If God's character, like some of us, were changeable, a bit like the weather. What if God's character was changeable like some of us? How then could we truly follow him? How could we believe anything he says? Because he's just changing his mind. Where would be the confidence that we have to follow the Lord if he was a changeable God? Keep shifting the goalposts. No, he's not a changeable God. He's the same yesterday, the same today, and he's the same forevermore. Oh. One must now examine the statement in Hebrews 13 in terms of the past, the present, and the future. In other words, how does this unchanging God, this immutable God, find application in my life today? What does it mean for me personally that God, Jesus, the same yesterday, today, and forever? After all, I'm living in the now. I don't have access to the past. The past is gone. And I certainly don't know what's going to happen in the future. Anybody in here know? So how then can I apply this word to my own life today? Well, first of all, let us look at Hebrews chapter 13 again, verse 7. Remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken to you the word of God, whose faith you must follow, considering the end of their conversation. And another translation reads like this: remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their life, of their way of life, and then go on and imitate their faith. The writer is encouraging us to consider those who have taught us the word of God and to consider the results of their life. And then in turn, having watched them and saw how successful they were with God, he then challenges us to imitate them. Amen, somebody. Why should we imitate them? Because the writer seems to be suggesting that what they learn from God and what they receive from God has stood them in good stead. Well, you're not hearing me, praise God. The things that they learned from God caused them to be who they were. This is why we celebrate them. This is why we remember them. This is why, as you begin to remember, you hold these people in high esteem, because you saw their works and you know that the God who was with them did awesome things in their lives. You saw how they turned out, and now the writer is saying, go ahead and imitate them. Behave like them. Paul was saying that walking with Christ and obeying Christ was the thing that worked. And I can't make this point enough. We used to sing a song, give me that old time religion. And I don't remember all of the words, but some of it, it was good enough for, and it will be good enough for me. There are certain principles that we know from the God of yesterday, that we've learned from the men and women of yesterday, that was very good for them. Oh, help me somebody. I said it was very good for them. It was challenging, but they knuckled down and they obeyed because it was good and it produced good results. And the writer is saying the same way that God handled the people who have gone yesterday, I want you to see what they did and imitate what they did. And I guarantee you, you'll have good results. Oh, glory be to God. That's why the writer was able to say, follow me. Can anybody in here say, follow me as I follow Christ? Raise your hands if you can say that. Follow me. There's something about your life that is worth following. You may not be Mr. and Mrs. Perfect. You haven't got all the I's dotted and the T's crossed, but there's something about you that somebody can model. Oh, glory be to God. Hallelujah. It may be your righteousness. It may be your holiness. It may be the way that you treat people. It may be the way that you look after people. But there's something about you that even the young people can look at you and say, you know what? I want to be like her. I want to be like him. I know he isn't Jesus. I know she isn't Jesus. But there's something about them that I want to model and be like. Oh, glory be to God. Learn from the men and women of yesterday and imitate them, because the same thing that worked for them will also work for you. Amen. And so he encourages us, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication and with thanksgiving, let your requests be known unto God. But then he said, the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, my brethren, and I wish we would take this on board. Finally, my brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest. Did you hear what I'm saying? So we don't deal with falseness. We don't deal with dishonesty. Whatever things are true, whatever things are honest, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of a good report, if there is any virtue in these things, the writer says, think on these things. Those things which you have both, what? Learned and received and heard and seen in me. Do those things and the God of peace shall be with you. One of the problems that we don't have peace is because we're not doing the things that God said we should do. Trust me, saints, I've been a Christian since the age of 17, mass, 43 years, if you like. And I have learned in 43 years that my misery, my sadness, my unhappiness, my insecurity as a Christian always comes when I know I'm not doing what God wants me to do. The reason I can't sleep at night, the reason I can't smile properly, and I know some of us are very good at grinning, but on the inside there's a darkness taking place. The reason is you're not obeying the word of God. You don't want to obey the word of God. You've already made up your mind you're going down a certain path. You will not change. You will not move. But Jesus is the same yesterday. He cannot change to suit Sheffield Church. He cannot change. And there are times I'm trying to work things out. And there are times I'm trying to juggle what God is saying, juggling the word, trying to make the word fit into what I want to do. And every time I do it, Sister Lynn, I end up in failure. Because there's something called conviction. Where the spirit, even when you're grinning your teeth and carrying on like you're happy, there's something going on in the inside that you're not free. You're still bound. Dance all you like, still bound. Praise God all you like, but still bound. There's something on the inside that has not been worked out, and it's always predicated around disobeying the word of God. And I promise you, saints, I promise you, I may not be Paul and Silas, I may not be one of the ancients, but I promise you, after 43 years of living with Christ, I promise you, there is no rest and there is no peace. Hallelujah! I promise you, until the Lord has his way, the smiling won't do it. Coming to Bible study won't do it. Coming to church doesn't do it. You've got to make some time in your life where you say, God, enough is enough. I want to be like you, because you changeth not. The world is changing, but you, God, change not. Mighty God. Somebody pray for me. I feel alone. Hallelujah. Paul is dead and gone now. But the same Christ that Paul followed has not changed. What was good for Paul in Christ back then is good for us in Christ today. What was holy and true for the Apostle Paul and other great men and women in the past is still holy and true for us today. No matter what we want to do, sometimes to change the Bible and change the meaning of the text to suit our lifestyles in 2024. It is never and will never be acceptable to God. And we will ultimately be judged not by our peers. Because you know what? Because some of your peers will side with you. Oh, you didn't hear that. I said some of you are so close as buddies and friends, you will side with one another in your sin and in your degradation and in your unholiness because your best pals grew up in Jamaica, grew up in Africa, coffee every single day. It doesn't matter. What is wrong is wrong. And God is looking for someone to say, you know what? I love you with all of my heart, but I can't back this. Oh, God. That isn't easy. Not when you love people. But we are talking about eternal destiny. We're talking about a God who hasn't changed. Oh, God. Lord, there's some things I want to say, but I have to behave myself. Because it's the whole church changing, you see. It's the whole denomination. It's churches everywhere are twisting everything. Lord, have mercy. It is not even the people in the pew so much, you know. It's the big people, them. The ones who should know better. The ones that I grew up listening to. The ones I would sit down like a wide-eyed little boy and say, "Woo, he's coming to preach." It's them who are changing. And if we change as ministers, what are the young people supposed to do? Pure confusion. Everything mash up. Nobody knows what's going on. Everybody doing what is right in their own sight. But I'm here to tell you prophetically, Jesus is the same. Yesterday. Hallelujah. And today. So Jesus is the same yesterday, but what about today? Well, as long as you are breathing, we will, all of us in this room, will have to deal with life. And everything that life brings. I told you about the I call him the late great Bishop Levi Bailey, who I ran to him at a difficult time in my ministry, well before I got here. And I told him about all my problems and all the things I was going through. You know what his advice was? Well, in life there is challenges. I looked at her, I thought, hey, that's all you have to say to me? He said, well, in life there is challenges. These days we need a session, a 1 hour session, when sometimes what is true is just true. In life, there are challenges for all of us. Every single, you can't get away from it, you know, saints. There are challenges. Some of us will suffer heartbreak that other people won't suffer. Isn't that amazing? Some of us will have to deal with particular stresses that some people will never encounter. The path of life is strained and difficult. It is often set with traps and snares and obstacles. Obstacles that none of us were quite prepared for. You know, am I talking, say, you know that you get up in the morning, you have your devotional. You have your prayer time, or if you're one of these people that do it in the evening, whenever you do it. And you kind of pray to God, and you say, God, bless the day ahead of me. Lord, cover me for every eventuality. Cover me, Lord, for the things I can see and the things I don't see. And there's a temptation that after you've prayed, that you go about your business, and you just think that everything is going to be well, and then here comes a little curveball. Nobody knew it was coming. That is what life is, brothers and sisters. Oh, God. And since I'm living today in this life, I need a Jesus who is true to his word. As true to his word as he's always been. That's what I need. I don't know about you. I need a Jesus who is as true to his word today as he has ever been. I need a God who has the power to be a light in my darkness. Oh, God. I need a God who sticks closer than a brother. The same way he stuck with Moses. The same way he stuck with the apostles. I need him to do that, the same thing for me. Well, I'm living in my life today. And I need the same God that Peter needed. A God that will never change his mind about me. Come on, help me somebody. Let me say that again. It's for somebody in here. I said, I need a Peter. I need a God that Peter needed. A God who will never change his mind about me. Even when I embarrass myself and mess up and go into hiding, I need a God that will look for me and forgive me and come see about me. That's the kind of God I need. I don't need the criticism. I may deserve it, but it isn't helping me. I need a God who will come and correct me. Oh, hallelujah. I need the same God that David needed. The kind of God that even after I have done heinous and diabolical things, he will look not at what I did, but at who I could become. A God like David's God, who will forgive me of my sin and then turn around and call me a man after God's own heart. Hallelujah. Anybody hear what I'm saying? I need a God that the woman caught in adultery needed. A God who even after she had been caught in a sin that was worthy of death, Jesus says to her, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. I'm living my life today and I need a God like the man at the pool of Bethesda needed. Because you know what? Sometimes I get sick. Sometimes my body doesn't function how it should. And I need a God that will just come to me and heal my body. Anybody here know what I'm talking about? I need a God that can heal. I don't need a God who's forgotten how to heal. I need a God who could heal all my diseases. And look at me and say, son, rise up and walk. That's the kind of God I need. I need a God like the woman of Zarephath. But sometimes when I don't even have what it takes to pay my bills, Sometimes I'm poor and needy, but I need a God who will come to me and say, Winston, you know what? I'm going to bless you. And I declare unto you, son, that your barrel shall never be empty of meal, neither shall your cruse of oil fail. I need a God, the same God who did it yesterday, a God who will supply all of my needs. Somebody say all. All of my needs according to his riches in glory. And I don't know about you, but I'm so glad that I serve a God who is the same yesterday, the same today. Oh, somebody, and he's the same tomorrow. Same yesterday, same today, same tomorrow. In 1 Peter 2, chapter 1, the Apostle Paul writes these encouraging words to those who served the Lord back then and to those of us who are serving the Lord today. And he says this, and I love this verse. He says, his divine power has given us everything that we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him, which called us by his own glory and grace. Through these he has given to us very great, hear me now, and precious promises. Somebody say promises. So that through them ye may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. Saints, we are living in the world today. And as I mentioned a couple of weeks ago, we are living with this eschatological expectation of a better day ahead. Amen, somebody. You and I are laboring in God's vineyard as a response to his saving grace, as a response to his loving kindness, as a response to his mercy. We are living in the now, but we eagerly anticipate tomorrow. Tomorrow is coming. We are living in the now, but there is a glorious expectation of that which is to come, the day when all of us shall see Jesus. Hallelujah. The reason we are able to look forward, saints, is predicated upon the promises of Almighty God. Great and precious promises that make the people of God not ashamed. We have the strength to go forward because we have faith in God. Amen. We are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation. It is our faith, coupled with that eschatological hope, coupled with the promises of God that keep us going day by day, knowing that the same God who worked for the men and women of old is the same God that will open up your way for the future. Oh, somebody praise God. Our God is the great promise keeper. Amen. He is the keeper of our souls. He's never made a promise that he will not keep. I bet everybody in this building has made a promise that you didn't keep. I don't think that there are any exceptions. But the God that I serve, once he makes a promise, it is sealed. And so he says things like, you know what, saints, Sheffield Church? Surely, goodness. Oh, God. Come on, look here. Surely, goodness, mercy shall follow me. You mean some? A few days? 2024? All the days of my life. And I will what? Dwell in the house of the Lord forever. He says in Isaiah 1:18, come now. What a beautiful promise. Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. I love this. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, oh, they shall be like wool. That must comfort somebody today. It has to comfort somebody in church. Though your sins I said, though your sins are red like scarlet, they shall be as white as wool. He says in Ezekiel 36, 26, I will give you a new heart. And I will put a new spirit in you. He says in Matthew 11, 28, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. I beg of you, learn of me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. He says in Acts 2, 21, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. He says in John 7, 38, whosoever believes in me, as scripture has said, out of their bellies, from their bellies will flow rivers of living waters. John 14, 3, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. Oh, glory be to God. He doesn't lie. God is not a man that he should lie. Nor the Son of Man that he should repent. He said, if I go, I'll prepare a place for you, and I will come again, and I will receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Saints of God, tell your neighbor, stick with Jesus. Come on, tell your neighbor, stick with Jesus. Don't go anywhere, stick with Jesus. Because I promise you, he's the same. And brothers and sisters, don't be too hard on people who change on you. Don't be too hard. Remember, they're human. You don't like it, you don't love it, it irritates you. But remember, they're human. They will change. No matter how they chat, they will change. But we have a God who will not change. Oh, glory be to God. Stick with Jesus. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And just one more precious promise before I bring this word to a conclusion. Jesus has this promise that reaches way back to the past and moves forward to today and reaches out into the future. And because he is the same yesterday and today and forever, he gave us this precious promise, I will never leave you. Nor will I ever forsake you. And because he has said this, now we can confidently say that the Lord is my helper. Oh God. That is why I have this confidence that I'm going to make it, you know, saints. I don't argue with people too much about if I'm going to make it. I believe I'm going to make it. Because God is my helper. He's my helper. When I fall, he'll help me. When I struggle, he'll help me. When I don't know what to do, he'll help me. But one of the things, saints of God, is that we got to stick with Jesus. And we got to understand. You see, this message will bring comfort to those who are in Christ and living good. But if you're not living good, it's not comfortable. Because he won't change, you see. I used to think that my father was one of the hardest men on the planet. I used to think sometimes my father used to be so strict. I used to wonder how I could get anything good out of him. But I noticed some things about my father after he had a good meal. After he come from church. If I did something particularly that he approved of, he would just mellow a little bit. Still tough like bone. But he would soften and he would change his stance. Oftentimes, on occasion, he would just say, you know what? Yes, we'll do what you want. Sometimes the stubbornness breaks down. Brothers and sisters, we change all the time. But there's a problem. There's a problem. Jesus Christ being the same yesterday, today, and forever means that there's a problem for some of us. There's a problem for Christendom that we can't have our cake and eat it. We can't do the things that we want to do and just expect God to go along with it. He is too holy. He is too righteous. When he settles something in heaven, it is settled. It is now our responsibility to go along with what he says. Otherwise, we suffer consequences that may not be good for us. Can I just say, and I believe that the Holy Spirit is telling me to say this, do not look at your friends and your family and your neighbors who have got away with sinful living and God didn't kill them on the spot and say to yourself, well, I can do what I want to do because they got away with it. And I believe that Jesus is just going to have to handle my sin. You are dealing with a righteous God. You are dealing with a righteous judge. The same one that died on the cross and gave his blood. One of these days, he's going to judge us. We have to live correctly. We have to live right. The same God who pours out love is the same God that will send us to the pit of hell. Don't look at how your neighbor is living and say they got away with it. Let me try God. Because if you try God, you may not survive. If you test him, you may not live. Holiness unto the Lord. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If we live by faith, saints, if we get to a point in our lives where even though we don't understand all the nuances of God, even if we don't understand everything that is going on, I would encourage you, oh God, I would encourage you, have a quiet time with God. Have a quiet time with God. Believe every word he says. Have confidence in Almighty God. Be unwavering in your confidence in God. And then when we are unwavering, when we know the God that we serve, hear what the Word of God says, let us then, therefore, come boldly to the throne of grace, so that we may do what? Obtain mercy, and that we may find grace in a time of our need. Hallelujah. 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 I find myself a lot of the time these days just saying, God, search me. Every day I question who I am. You see, my particular problem is that I'm still struggling, and maybe I'll get there one day, but I'm still struggling with the fact that a God of heaven could love someone like me. That's my struggle. And on some days I struggle with that. But it's like the Holy Spirit just says, just believe the word. You are who you are. You are the righteousness of God. I have called you. I have ordained you. I have anointed you. I have appointed you. But sometimes when things aren't going so well, we can revert back to that. Oh, I wonder, does anybody hear what I'm saying? Maybe I'm the only imperfect one in here. Maybe I'm the only one who thinks like that. But I'm grateful for the mercy of God. Oh, I'm grateful. And I'm grateful that he doesn't change. Because if he changed, then the thing that he hated yesterday, he would accommodate today. But he doesn't, you see. And we can measure our lives based not on what people think about us, but on the word of God. He is the same. Oh, brethren, don't let this word be a trouble to you. What I would say to you, in all honesty, is adjust your life to the word. That's the best way you're going to get out of this. Adjust your life to the word. And I'm looking in heaven right now, and I'm seeing the sheep, and I'm seeing the goats separated, and I'm seeing some loved ones. And I'm seeing some people who thought that they were going to make it in. But you're not going to make it in because with all your talk, you're corrupt. With all your talk, you're corrupt. You're not living good. You only act a certain way when you come to church. That's why the Lord said, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, shall enter. Because you can't play God. You can't play God. You know, this is not a McDonald's or a KFC God that you could have it any way you want. This is a God who's righteous. And I think our church is at a turning point. I speak prophetically, and I believe that in a few years to come, our church may well be at war. Not because we hate each other, you know, but because there's some doctrinal stuff that we're dealing with and some beliefs that we have held dear, and we're kicking them to the curb. We're throwing them away in the name of convenience. The Bible says every man was doing what is right in their own eyes. But I'm here to warn somebody. As I warn myself. As I warn my own heart. Jesus is the same. Yesterday. The same today. The same forever. Change is all around us, and there are still changes to come, saints of God, which I believe will blow our minds. We're talking about the sexuality. We're talking about all the stuff that's coming in now. I believe that there's greater changes coming in our world that's going to blow our mind. You know, I often think about Elder Makinoff, you know, at the age of 94 years old. I don't believe that Elder Makinoff could have thought that one day before he died that we'll be asking, what is a man and a woman? I'm serious. In all of his wildest dreams, I don't believe that he would have come to the end of his life thinking that the world has changed so much that we don't know the difference between a man and a woman. Times are changing. Times are changing. But Jesus' character never changes. His teachings don't change. His word remains constant across all time, yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And this same Jesus, saints, will be your source of stability. And he will be your source of hope. And I promise you, if you live according to the word of God, you will get up in the morning and you will breathe and you will know that there is now therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but who walk after the Spirit. Let Christ be your stability, a Christ who never changes, God of the past, God of today, God of the future. He will never change. Bless the name of the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Saints of God, what a challenge we are faced with. What a challenge we are faced with in a changing world to remain true to the God that we serve. To remain true to the God that we love. To remain true to the God who we have called our Father. What a challenge. But I'm here to tell you, it is a challenge worth taking on. God will help you. Changing times, changing world. But Jesus Christ is the same. Do you believe that, saints? Do you believe that, saints? If you believe it, live accordingly. That's all I will say. If you believe it, live accordingly, and you will be blessed. Stand if you would, please. Hallelujah. I didn't realize that our brother Isaiah would be here today. I thought maybe he had changed his mind and gone, but I saw him come on. I'd just love to invite you just to pray. Maybe just pray our closing prayer, my brother, if you would at this time. And as he heads on the train back to London, we'll be praying for him as he goes into his next ministry assignment. If you want to see what happened last night, go to the New Testament Church of God YouTube channel, and you'll see the service. But please continue to pray for this brother. It's a good thing he's the same yesterday, today, and forever, isn't it? Because if you knew his background, but God has a habit of changing things, changing people. That's why I love him. That's why I love him. Brothers, just go and pray for the church.
Father, we give you thanks, we give you praise, we give you the honor, we give you the glory. Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you, Father, for the power of your word. For Lord, you said in your word that you are now clean through the word that I've spoken unto you. Father, we thank you for your servant who has had the boldness and the courage to give us your word and to declare your heart. And Father, we thank you that your word is sharper than a two-edged sword. Father, it gets between joints and marrow, and it discerns our hearts and shows us what we need to do. Father, we thank you for the word of truth, because Lord, this is the word that cleanses and renews and uplifts us. Now, Father, I ask in the name of Jesus that the seed of the word would go deep in our hearts. I pray, Father God, that the words that we've heard today, Father God, will take root and bear much fruit. I pray, Father God, that we will become a reflection of the things that we have heard. Father, as we leave this place, I pray that the Holy Spirit will bring back to our memory throughout the week the things that we've heard. Father, inspire us. Father, empower us. Give us the grace, Father God, to live out these true words. Lord, the song says, ancient words, ever true, changing me, changing you. We come before you, Father, with open hearts. Let the ancient word impart. I pray, Father God, that as we leave, your Holy Spirit will go before us. Let the truth of this word pursue us. Father, empower us and help us to be the disciples and the followers that you've called us to be. Father, we thank you for the street mission that we did yesterday. We thank you, Father, that the gospel was preached. And now, Father, we ask that the doors of this church would stay open. Father God, that men and women that heard the gospel will come into this house, Father, and find a place to hear the word. We pray, Father God, that you would stir this church, Father, with a fresh fire. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would breathe upon this church, Father, that the spirit of evangelism and discipleship would go forth with power, with signs and wonders following. Father, I pray for the older generation. I pray, Father God, that you would stir up every gift that's in them. Father, I thank you that your word says our latter shall be greater. And better is the end of a thing and then the beginning. And so, Father, we pray you would stir the mothers. We pray you would stir the fathers. Father, we pray that the young people will be on fire. We pray that there will be no gap between generation to generation. For your word says that one generation shall tell another generation of the goodness of the Lord. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would have your way in this church. Father, let your kingdom come and let your will be done. Lord, I pray it will be on earth as it is in heaven. Father, let the spirit of deliverance flow through this house. I pray, God, that chains will be broken. Lord, I pray that the captives will be set free. Father, you did it for me many years ago when I was in prison as a crack cocaine addict. You met me in my prison cell and you broke my addiction and you set me free and you put a song in my mouth. And Father, today I stand as a minister of the gospel by the grace of your glory. God, I pray that that same presence would sweep through this church. I pray that men and women would encounter your power. Men and women would encounter your glory and they will go forth and declare the gospel. In the name of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that sick bodies will be healed. Yeah. God, I pray that sick bodies will be healed. I pray in the name of Jesus that the spirit of healing would move for this house. I pray that cancers will disappear. God, I pray that diabetes will dry up. I pray that blood pressure will come into alignment. Father, our bodies are your temple. And so I pray that the glory of the Lord would arise upon the temples of your people in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, your word says that you would, that we above all things be in good health and prosper. And so God, we speak health, we speak freedom, we speak healing and deliverance in the name of Jesus Christ. God, I pray for peace in our families. I pray for salvation in our families. God, I pray that our family members will come to this church. Our children will come to this church. You said, believe upon the
the Lord Jesus, and you and your household shall be saved. Father, we pray for prodigal sons. We pray for prodigal daughters. We pray for those that used to come and have gone astray. Oh God, I pray you will send your spirit and bring them back to their rightful place, that they will find their place in the house of God. Let this house be a lighthouse. Let this be a house of deliverance. Let this be a house of freedom. Let this be a house of restoration. Let this be a house of breakthrough, I pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. God, I pray for the drug addicts. I pray for the prostitutes. I pray for the gunmen. I pray for the rich, Lord. I pray for the poor. I pray they will find a place in this house. Father, send the politicians. Send the governors. You said, my house shall be a house of prayer for all people. And so, Father, we pray that all would come. They will come and worship. They will come and surrender and be submitted and do your will. These things we ask. Lord, bless this week. Let it be a good week. Let it be a favorable week. Let it be a week of blessing. Let it be a week of favor. God, I pray that this week we would hear your voice. I pray, God, you would lead us. Atalabahosa. I pray you would lead us like a good shepherd. Father, the steps of a good man, they are ordered by God. Order our steps, I pray, and give us your peace. Father, we speak the peace of God here. We speak the peace of God, the peace that passes human understanding over our bodies, our spirits, our souls, our families, our finances, our relationship, over all that we have. We give it to you. Father, take our little fish and our five loaves. Take the little that we have and multiply it. Father, break it and bless it, I pray. Father, we speak a blessing over this house and over these people. Come on, just lift your hands and receive it. Come on, lift your hands and receive it. I said lift your hands and receive it. Come on, lift your hands and receive it. Let the blessing of the Lord that makes rich and has no sorrow be upon you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Bless you, my brother. God bless you. Praise the Lord. Come on, put your hands together for Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Been such a wonderful weekend, and we give God thanks. And we give God thanks for all of you. Amen. All of you. All of you are important. All of you are valuable. All of you have been brought by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Brethren, don't waste what you have. Don't give it away. Stick with Christ. Whatever the master says, do. Whatever the master says, change. Change it. Change it, because he is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. So to God I commit you, and to God I commend you. But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be all glory, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Amen. Make sure that you don't leave before shaking somebody's hand and greeting them. Amen. Remember to greet the newcomers. Those who are here for the first time, greet them with the love of the Lord.